Praise God for that message, right?
Yes,
So today what we're going to be talking about is from Ephesians chapter 5. And we're going to be basically staying in that chapter. And so what we're going to do is we're going to break down this whole chapter verse by verse. So some of you may not be familiar with this chapter. Something important to understand when you're reading the scriptures, you look at the beginning of the book. Especially with the books that are written by Paul. And you look at the context of what he's talking about. And you can often see who he's talking to. So in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1, we can see who he's talking to. He starts off like this. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by God's will. To the faithful saints in Christ Jesus. Who is he talking to? The faithful saints. The body of Christ, the church. So then we can go back into Ephesians 5. And we can have a clear understanding of what he's talking about and who he's talking to. So I know some of you are taking notes, so what I'll do is I'll give you some titles for these sections. So what we're
going
to do is we're going to look at verse
1
to verse
5
in chapter 5. This could easily be titled A Call to Walk in Love. And so what he's doing, he's talking to the church and he's giving instructions for us today. You're going to see something beautiful as we just dissect this scripture. I want to paint a picture of what we are as a church. It should move us, it should inspire us. It should humble us. And leave us in awe of the Holy God. So let's start off with the first section. Starting with verse 1. Therefore be imitators of God. As beloved children. And walk in love. As Christ loved us and gave himself up for us. A fragrant offering of sacrifice to God. With sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not even be named among you. As it is proper among saints. Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, nor out of place. But instead, let there be thanksgiving.
Amen.
For you may be sure of this, that everyone who is sexually immoral, or impure, or is covetous, that is an idolater, has no inheritance in the kingdom of Christ. So let's break down those verses. First verse, he's saying, be followers of God, imitating Christ's example. He's saying, take up your cross and follow me. He's saying, empty yourself of yourself and seek me. Don't depend on your own works and your own
ability.
But depend on Christ and he will
work.
He's saying, as he says in Philippians, work out your salvation. Because he's doing a work in you, and he's producing works in you. According to God's will and for his glory. Because the thing is that even your good works,
you see, this is the number,
are not of you. They're things that God, who is sovereign over all things, he predestined before you ever born. He knew that before I was ever born that I would be here right now. This is not me, this is the work of God. I get no glory for this. I'm a wretched sinner that deserves the punishment of God, and yet by his grace. Given me the honor to be able to share with you. Out of love and devotion for my Christ and for my love for my people. Just
think,
that was verse 1. And then he goes on in verse 2 and he says, walk in love as Christ loved. Think about the example of Christ. He was truly man and truly God. God humbled himself to become man so that he could be and live the life we could not
live.
And be our substitute on the cross. He lived a life perfect. In Hebrews it says that you have a God that is sympathetic with every temptation you face. Think about that. Jesus experienced every single temptation that we've ever experienced. And yet he never sinned. He lived the life he could not. And now he's on the throne and doing intercession. He's praying for you. He says, he sees when you're weak and you're falling into temptation. And he's praying for you, he's like, give him strength.
I want to persevere.
I will not help him to turn away from sin. And so then you think about the sacrifice that he made for us. It says here, a fragrant offering. Think about it. You were dead in your sins. Romans 3 says that no one is good and no one seeks God. And yet before you were born, he knew you. And every believer here, he chose you. The word of God says that it was past tense. He says, I foreknew you. I predestined you to be saved. I already adopted you before you were ever born. I already justified you, made you right before God. I already sanctified you. I already glorified you in heaven. Our God is sovereign, He knows all things. And even His grace is sovereignly ordained by Him. He bore the wrath that you deserved on the cross. When he was on the cross, he was thinking of you. The wrath of God that was penetrating his body while he was dying. Was shielding you from the wrath of that of God. So you think about walking in love as Christ did. It's to live like Christ. And we're not perfect, and we can't be just like Christ. But with His power, He helps us to sin less. John MacArthur once said, he was a pastor in the United States. He says, you sin less and you feel worse. What does that mean? It means that the more you're sanctified, you sin less. And when you do sin, you feel bad. And you hate your sin. And you turn from it. And so you see in these verses where he's talking about don't be sexually immoral, don't be impure. He's talking about what your speech is. He's talking about what you say, what you do, and how you behave. And instead of talking like that and living like that, live a thankful life to God. See, the thing is, if you look at that verse, he's talking to the church. But he knows that there's people within that church that are not true believers.
Yes.
And he goes and he says, okay, for you goats that are among the sheep. If you're an idolater, if you are sexually immoral, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. But for my elect, my chosen, those that hate their sin are striving for holiness, that you will inherit the kingdom of God. So, now let's look now at verse 6. Let no one deceive you with empty words. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not become partners with them. For at one time you were in darkness. But now you are the light of the Lord. Walk as children of light. The fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. So think about these words. He's calling us to be the light of the world. He just warned us about being impure. And then he gave a warning about those that are impure amongst the church. He's also referring to those false believers and false prophets. And he says that they would not inherit the kingdom of God. They will face the wrath. That is a fearful thing. But then he goes on to say, but walk as children of light. Because you were once in darkness, but now you are the light of in the Lord. Think about the beauty of that. So in the verses 7-14, you can title that section a call to walk as children of light. And then you can look at verse 10 and try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. How do you discern what is pleasing to the Lord? Well, there's two ways. Father, there's the Holy Spirit that dwells within you. We often ignore that spirit that is speaking to you and saying, don't do that sin, watch out for this, watch out for that. And we must know the Word of God. It must be within us so much that everything we do, we compare to the Word. Verse 11, take no part in unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. So you see these things that are happening around us that are dark and they're
evil.
Expose them to the power of the gospel. In order for people to understand the good news of the gospel, they need to know the bad news. They need to know that for all have sinned and fall short of the
glory.
And without the redemption of Christ in your life, you will face the wrath of God. So we need to expose them. Verse 12, for it is shameful even to speak of the things they do in secret. See, these false teachers and false converts, they look like, from the outside, holy.
Go.
But Jesus once said to the Pharisees, who knew all the right words to say, they wore robes that were of fancy, and he called them whitewashed tombs. What does that mean? He was saying they were a tomb of dead, spiritually dead people. That looked beautiful on the outside, but were dead in the inside. Verse 13, but when anything is exposed to the by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Think about that. You and I as the church are the light of the world. It doesn't serve anything if we are the light within this building. And yet outside live in darkness. If we are living just like the world, they won't see the light. But when you practice what you preach, and you live accordingly to the word of God, you will be a light to your family and all those who come in contact with you. And when they see you, they're going to see something different in you. They see something in the way you behave. They see you talk different, you walk different. You're constantly talking about the gospel. And as they see that, they feel very uncomfortable. Because the gospel is offensive to people. It's a joy to those that have been saved. Because we know that we were wretched sinners saved by grace. But for those dead in sins, they put up a wall. Because no man seeks God without God transforming their heart. Here he's saying that you will expose their sins when you come in contact with them. When you share the gospel with them, it will expose their sins. And then he says something here. He says, arise from the dead. Ephesians chapter 2 says, you were dead in your trespasses and sins. How does a dead person accept Christ? God has to give him a new heart. But if you're dead in your sin, how are you going to choose God? How are you going to have faith? It says in Ephesians 2, it goes on to say, even your faith is a gift from me. Think how beautiful that is. That here you are, dead in your sins, and in the perfect timing that God ordains, you heard the gospel and he transformed your life. That's called regeneration. And that produces faith. All of a sudden you begin to mourn over your sins. And the only thing you can do is repent and say, I hate my sin. I don't want to do this anymore. I'm tired of carrying the burden. I need set free from the sins. That was God's work in your life. And then he calls you to an action to repent. He justifies you and makes you right before God. He seals you with the Holy Spirit and says, you are mine. And the Holy Spirit guides you in your life. The sin less to be more like you. And think about this, children. At one point, you were an enemy of God. but now you're adopted and you're a child. You can now call him Father. He's saying here that when you're the light of the world and you share the gospel, he calls people the dead and that are dead in their sins to rise up. And then in verse 15, we can say a call to walk as wise. And it says, look carefully then how you walk. Not as unwise, but as wise. Making the best use of the time. Because the days are evil. Therefore do not be foolish. But understand the will of the Lord is. Don't get drunk with wine. For that is debauchery. But be filled with the Spirit. Addressing one another in psalms and hymns. And in spiritual songs. And singing and making melody to the Lord with
God.
Giving thanks always and for everything. To God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus
Christ.
Submitting one to another. Out of reverence for Christ. See these beautiful words he's saying to us as a church. Don't walk as fools, walk as wise
people.
According to his word.
And
we need to redeem the time. For the days are evil. See, we're in the last days. No man knows the hour when Jesus
comes.
It could be today or tomorrow. And that's why today we need to live. We need to live today as if it's the last day on earth. We need to live holy like Christ. And we need to tell as many people about Christ. Because we don't want anyone to perish. Redeem the time. And so we need to understand the will of the Lord. We need to be filled with the Spirit. When we walk down the streets that we are praying. And we're constantly thinking and praying. And seeking the will of God in everything. We need also, as it says here, as if we need to address one another in psalms and hymns. Think about the first century church. They were being persecuted. People stoned to death. Hung on trees. Burned to death, all sorts of
things.
And yet they would sing to each other. They would sing the songs. They would sing songs to one another. So think about it. In the beginning we read that don't let any foolish talk come from your mouths. And now he's given us instructions to speak to one another with love and gentleness. With words of encouragement. Singing songs of thanksgiving for what the Lord has done.
this is the beautiful thing of the body of Christ. We assemble together to edify one another. He closes that last section in 21. And he says, submit to one another out of reverence of Christ. What does that submission mean? It means I'm no better than you. We are equals. And I respect you. I respect the gifts that God has given you. You respect the gifts that God has given me. We use them accordingly to His will.
To
lift each other up. That's a beautiful expression right there. But then he goes on and he addresses the husbands and wives. And see, the beauty of this section is the gift of marriage yes, it helps us to be able to create life. It helps us to live pure lives because we're not being sexually immoral. But he uses two different people that have different personalities to sanctify one another. Because you have to love one another. See, the thing is, a lot of people go and say, well, you don't know my situation. You don't know my wife or my husband.
So when you say,
but the Bible says, love them. Well, my husband or my wife, they don't show me love.
Nah.
They don't show me love.
Yes, sir.
They say, you might say, well, we're living separately right now. But what does the Bible say? Love your neighbor. When we're fighting and we're almost like enemies. What does the Bible say? Love your enemy. See, this is the power of the gospel. Marriage is supposed to show the love of Christ to His bride. When people see a Christian marriage, they understand the relationship between Christ and His church. As Sean mentioned, that we were also referred to as the bride. Many people take this section of the scriptures out of context. And so we want to explain this in this correct context. So let's read 22:33. Wives, submit to your husbands.
Go, mamay.
As to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church. Which is His body and is Himself is the Savior. Now, if the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to everything to their husbands. So think about the original design of man. When we came into this world, we were in the image of God. And we were in a perfect state. We were in a perfect state. That means that we, that Adam and Eve, man and woman, lived in harmony without ever single fight. That is the will of God. But because of our sinfulness, we have conflict.
Oh,
but listen to this beautiful thing that when God created man and woman, okay, Genesis 2:20-25. The man gave names to all the livestock. He gave names to all the livestock animals. To the birds of the sky, and to every wild animal. But for the man, no helper was found corresponding to him. So the Lord God caused the deep sleep to come over the man.
Okay, where wakula omundu esisecha wamwali yoye hukya.
And as he slept, God took one of his ribs, closed the flesh at that place. Then the Lord God made the rib. He had taken from the man into a woman. And God brought her to the man. And the man said, this one, at last, is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. The one will be called woman, for she is a man. This is why a man leaves his father and mother and bonds with his wife, and they become one flesh. But the man and his wife were naked and felt no shame. You see the purity of that. That God saw that man was lonely. That man could not do all this on his own. And he needed a helper. And so he gave specific roles for man and woman. So when the Bible says to submit to your own husband, it's saying to love and respect him. It's not saying that the man is to treat her like a second class citizen. They're equal in value. And yet they have different roles.
Right.
So as the bride of Christ, he's using the woman as an example of how we submit out of love and devotion to our husband Christ. See, there's an attack on marriage around the world. That maybe you're not aware of. And the thing is, in the United States, for example, it's now legal for a man and a man to get married.
In America,
this is a blasphemous attack on the biblical design of marriage.
Yes.
Which is to display the love of Christ and his bride.
na kuno ndebana kusima Kristo nende umuhaye sise nero siwe.
Many times we read that section and the men rejoice and the women are like, submission. Many times the men rejoice when they hear those words about the woman submitting. But the woman is just to respect and love her husband as a helper. But God gives man a difficult responsibility. Let's read this section here.
I was on
verse 25. Husbands, love your wives. As Christ loved the church. How much did God, Christ, love the church? He gave up heaven for his church. He became a humble servant to the church. He died for the church. Now, as husbands, are we living up to that kind of love for our wives?
No, no, no. What's
it goes on to say 26. That he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word. It's saying that the husband's role is to teach his wife and children. The word, to teach them in their houses every day the word of God. And by his life and his example and his teachings, that his wife will become more sanctified and be more holy. The children would hear the word of God. Through the power of God, he would transform
our
and our children who were sinners from the womb will come to know Christ as well. Do we as fathers have a burden for our children and the condition of their souls? If Christ came back today, would your child be taken to heaven with you? This should burden us. Every child that we take care of, with the home movement, with the orphans, we should have that same devotion in trying to care for their souls. So we wash over them with the word. 27, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor. Without spot or wrinkle. Or any such thing. That she may be holy without blemish. So he's showing that in marriage as an example that he wants holiness. He wants the holiness within the church. Holiness within a Christian marriage. So when the world sees us, we are in darkness. And then he goes on to 28. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as his own body. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh.
but nourishes and cherishes it. Just as Christ does the church. Because we are members of this body. So think about those words. Man should love his wife more than himself.
Yes.
At the same time, Christ said, love one another more than yourself.
Yes.
So you see that within the marriage context. The man loves his wife more than himself. He leads her and guides her and his children. His wife loves his others more than herself. So she respects and loves him and does her responsibilities as well. The husband cherishes her, he nourishes her. And then it goes on to say, 31. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother, and hold fast to his wife. So the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound. I am not saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself. And let the wife see that she respects her husband. So there's a section in scriptures where Jesus is testing people. And he says, if you don't hate your mother and father, you don't love me. He said, I did not come to bring peace. But I came with a suit.
Yes.
To divide. So what is he saying there? He's saying if your devotion is more to your father and mother and not to him, then you're not a true follower of Christ. He's trying to divide those that are not his from those that are his. He's separating the sheep from the goats. He's separating the tares from the wheat. And so this beautiful example that he uses marriage. He says that that's why a husband and wife leave their parents. And they become one flesh. We as Christians, we abandon the world. We abandon our sins. We abandon the comforts of this life for the sake of Christ. And we become one in Him. We become united with Christ as
the Christ.
And we become one as a body of Christ as the church. This is the beauty of the gospel. This is who you are. This is how we should live. We're a holy priesthood. Set aside to be holy. As Christ is holy. Now if you look at Revelation 5, verse 9. Here we're talking about this is the coming of all of us coming to Christ in heaven. What is this going to be composed of? So starting chapter 5, verse 9. Well, let's read from 8. When he took the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each one had a harp. Golden bowls filled with incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song. Listen to what his church sings before the Holy God. You are worthy to take the scroll, to open its seals, because you were slaughtered and you purchased your people. For God, by your blood, every tribe and language, and people and nation, you made them a kingdom, a priest to our God, and they will reign on earth. This life is temporary. But a day is coming when Christ will come. Come for his bride. And each person that he's called out will be united with Christ. Heavens and earth will be renewed in perfect state. And we will reign with him. So let the church say, come where Jesus comes. So I pray for revival over each church. That he will bring us back to the word of God and the sound teaching. That he will call us to holiness and we will live and obey it. And that we'll see a transformation in this church and in this community. And that the light will expose the darkness. And souls will come to Christ. His church will be purified. And God will be glorified. Amen. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you. God bless. Praise the Lord. Dear friends, a wonderful